Since you did so well on that question, I'll ask you another one. Who lives your Christian life? God? So you want to hold him responsible for the condition of your Christian life? Who lives your Christian life? This is pretty basic, right? You're doing it right now, every day. Who's living your Christian life? You say, I am. Really? You say, God is. I don't know whether you could convince everybody who knows you. You can't even answer that question. Listen to what Paul said. I am crucified with Christ. Nevertheless, I live. Yet, not I. He didn't know either.
Is it? The clip you just witnessed is an example of blasphemy. This blasphemy taught by John MacArthur is not taught by the Bible. The Apostle Paul taught no such thing. John MacArthur is wickedly saying that Galatians chapter 2 verse 20 is a contradiction, a verse that is self-referentially absurd. MacArthur is claiming that Galatians 2:20 is a logical paradox, an apparent contradiction that cannot be resolved, an antinomy. Or in simple language, MacArthur is saying that this verse is self-contradicting nonsense. Now this is an attack on the Bible. It is a rejection of sola scriptura. And it shows that MacArthur is not a Calvinist. MacArthur is claiming, again, that the Bible is false, self-contradicting, hopelessly confusing, and that it cannot be trusted. If you check your commentaries, you will find Martin Luther does not claim that Galatians 2:20 is an irreconcilable paradox. You will not find John Calvin saying Galatians 2:20 is a logical paradox. Nor will you see Matthew Henry teaching that Galatians 2:20 is an antinomy. And you will not see John Gill teach that Galatians 2:20 is an apparent contradiction that can never be harmonized. That's because those men did not believe that the Bible teaches the heresy of irreconcilable paradox. They didn't believe the Bible taught contradictions. Biblical Christianity teaches that the Bible alone is the logically consistent Word of God. The teachings of Scripture are not self-contradicting. They're not irreconcilable paradoxes. Nor are they apparent contradictions that cannot be harmonized. They're not antinomies, for the Bible would be false if its teachings were self-referentially absurd. I repeat this because it is important. You must have this clear. Biblical Christianity rejects John MacArthur's wicked heresy of irreconcilable paradox. Because, however, most people today have not been educated in basic logic and grammar, let's review one important teaching. A logical paradox is a contradiction. The premises of any logical paradox cannot be resolved. They cannot be harmonized and shown to be logically consistent, regardless of the amount of study. The Bible has no logical paradoxes, for its teachings are entirely consistent. Now, in contrast to that, a rhetorical paradox is an apparent contradiction or an alleged discrepancy. This means, to some people at first glance, it may appear to be an actual contradiction. But, with a bit of study, by comparing Scripture with Scripture, the apparent contradiction can be harmonized. The rhetorical paradox can be solved. The alleged discrepancy can be explained. That is, shown to be logically consistent. Now, there are some rhetorical paradoxes in the Bible. You might ask, why has God placed these rhetorical paradoxes in the Bible? The answer is so that you will have to diligently read and study your Bible. Solving puzzles makes you smarter, forces you to know your subject. And we are to know Scripture. For, as Jesus said, ye do err, not knowing the Scriptures. Now any Calvinist worth his salt will explain this to his audience. But John MacArthur is not a Calvinist. He's a lying huckster. He's a heretic. When the Bible says, I am crucified with Christ, nevertheless I live, then it is speaking of justification by faith alone. How are we crucified with Christ? By having our guilt charged to Christ, our surety, in a forensic and legal manner. We are dead to the law of God and its condemnation. For Christ expiated our sins and propitiated God's wrath in our stead, meriting our redemption, making atonement for us, and reconciling us to God. The work of our surety and substitute not only declares us to be legally dead to the law, but thanks to Christ's active obedience imputed freely to us by God, we are also judicially pronounced acquitted, justified, and are alive in Christ our righteousness. Justification by grace alone is the cause of our Christian life. The finished work of Jesus Christ alone is the sole basis for our acquittal before God, but also our sanctification, which the Holy Spirit works in us freely. The Christian life is also called sanctification in its wide sense. Sanctification in its narrow sense is the work of the Holy Spirit alone, by grace alone. Sanctification in its wide sense simply means that God alone regenerates us, creates faith in us, and sanctifies us, making us into new men. And this sanctification causes us to do good works to glorify God and to help our fellow man. That's sanctification in its wide sense. Justification, like sanctification, is entirely by grace alone. It is monergistic. We now live the Christian life only because Christ lived and died for us, sent the Holy Spirit to quicken us, give us a new heart, and Christ now abides in us, never to depart from us. We do not live the Christian life by our effort or synergistically by working with Christ. We do not generate our own faith. We do not regenerate ourselves. Christ alone does these things for us by sending the Spirit to apply the redemption he accomplished. We especially do not merit our justification, not in part nor in whole. Christ alone is our righteousness. Now, MacArthur says we cannot answer the question, who lives your Christian life, but the Bible does answer it, and we just did as well, because we gave the biblical answer. The Bible says, quote, being confident of this very thing, that he which hath begun a good work in you will perform it unto the day of Jesus Christ, end quote. Philippians chapter 1, verse 6. We can answer the question because we believe in divine causation. We believe that God has predestinated all things and brings them to pass. MacArthur believes that the Bible teaches the irreconcilable paradox that God predestines all things, yet somehow mysteriously we have free will. That's a contradiction, and that's why he can't answer the question. We believe that God is responsible for our Christian lives, for he alone quickens us unto life and makes us do good works and walk in his ways. Are our best works in this life perfect and without sin? No, but God has even forgiven our sin-tainted good works. So by faith they are acceptable to God, while those who work apart from faith are merely sinning. See Romans chapter 14, verse 23. Now God cannot be charged with evil, for there is no law above God. He can do whatsoever he wants with what is his. See Matthew chapter 20, verse 15. In this life, as Christians, we are, as Martin Luther said many years ago, simul justus et peccator, which is the Latin for simultaneously just and yet sinful. That is, Christians live the Christian life simultaneously justified before God, perfectly righteous in God's sight, and in Christ alone. Yet in ourselves, we are still sinful. Now the new man, fighting against an old sinful flesh, and this will continue until our death, and then we'll be glorified. There is no logical paradox here, no irreconcilable paradox, for the Bible is consistent, and MacArthur is dead wrong. Now, because John MacArthur holds to the heresy of irreconcilable paradox, he thinks that the Bible teaches logical contradictions. MacArthur thinks the Bible simultaneously teaches that God determines all things, yet man has free will. We went over that. MacArthur thinks that the Bible teaches that God lives our Christian lives, yet we live our Christian lives. MacArthur claims that salvation is by grace alone, then he turns around, as he did in 2014 at the Shepherd's Conference with R.C. Sproul, and they both contradicted salvation by grace alone by teaching that sanctification is the result of synergism. When you claim sanctification is the result of synergism, you are implying that salvation is not by grace alone, but by grace and works. But that's what happens when you have men who believe that the Bible has contradictions in it. They contradict the Bible and each other and themselves. The theology of men like John MacArthur is a self-contradicting mess, and they blasphemously charge that mess to the Bible. These men do not have a credible profession of faith, and it doesn't matter how many degrees they have, doesn't matter how long they've pastored in some church, nor how many books they have written, nor how long they have taught seminary. I think you get the point. In conclusion, the Bible is logically consistent. God determines all things. Men and angels do not have free will from God. Salvation is entirely monergistic and completely by grace alone. And the Christian life we live is by faith alone. And Christ alone is the source of that life. Amen.